Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you all for coming. We're starting just a little bit late. Not too bad, I guess. I'm Philip Berkowitz. I'm a lawyer with a law firm called Littman Mendelson. We are actually the largest labor and employment law firm in the United States, and we are privileged to do a fair amount of work with Bank of China, and so we really appreciate the invitation to come here. And we appreciate all the help of the China General Chamber of Commerce and Candace New and everybody else and all of her team. I want to just take a moment actually to ask, we have a couple of speakers, one of whom many of you probably know, Alan Wong and Elaine LaRoche. I wonder if we could ask Elaine, do you mind introducing yourself for the folks here?
Thank you, it's a pleasure to be here. And thank you for inviting me. In 1995, when I was a partner at Morgan Stanley, we formed the first joint venture Chinese investment bank with the government of China. And I have been involved in CICC since its inception and was the CEO in Beijing from 97 to 2001. And when we decided to open up offices in New York, London, and Singapore, I joined the firm to help them establish the New York office in 2009. So I have been with CICC over a long period of time. Thank you.
And CICC is, I think, the largest investment bank in China, aren't you?
Well, not the largest in terms of number of people, but we would like to think we are the Goldman Sachs of China.
Okay, very good. And you're the Jamie Dimon of Okay, and Alan, tell us, I know you've been here for about 50 years now, or no?
Well, I'm not exaggerating, as I always said, I joined the bank when I was 9 years old.
Is this on?
Yes. I did turn it on. My name is Alan Wong. I'm with the Bank of China, head of human resources. Back in 85, after graduating from college, I was just trying to find something that I found within myself, and I started off in an agency, and Bank of China, surprisingly, was my account. I was placing people. I think after half a year, they figured, you know, they'd be paying me a lot of commission, might as well just let me work on the other side of the table. 32 years down the road, I've been the person who spearheaded the recruiting, ending up that I run the entire HR shop. A very interesting turn from a very small office, probably the time that I joined 85 people, up to where we're at right now, over 600 staff. We moved up to the building about a year ago, and right now, you know, we continue to expand. So as the company expands, certainly will come along with a lot of different issues, challenging issues among others, you know, human resources issues. So Phil has been helping us for the last 15 years, more or less, and helping us in addressing and resolving issues to that degree.
Okay, great. Okay, thank you. So, you know, the China General Chamber of Commerce very discreetly called this a program on etiquette. I think that if we had made it clear that it was about sex, we might have gotten more people coming. Sex and Power was the original title that I gave it, but it was censored a little bit. So, in any event, I want to give a little bit of a background before we get started, and we hope to make this kind of a dialogue. And, of course, we'll take questions. Feel free to raise your hand and speak up. But I want to just do a little bit of a background, and that is to say that, you know, sex harassment is not an issue, a new issue in the U.S. or for that matter in China. Just to give a little bit of a history, in 1964 in the U.S. we passed what's called the Civil Rights Act, which made sex discrimination illegal. In 1976, the Supreme Court, the U.S. Supreme Court, recognized sex harassment as a form of sex discrimination and therefore unlawful. 1980, the EEOC, which is the agency that oversees the enforcement of the federal law, issued regulations defining sex harassment. And just a few years later, the Supreme Court in 1986 considered whether when conduct is welcome or whether it's voluntary. Because there's a difference between somebody going along with something because they have to go along with it, or whether conduct is actually welcome. And so the courts recognized that somebody may feel that they have to go along with sexual behavior if their boss is forcing them to, even if they don't necessarily want to. So there's a critical distinction between voluntary behavior and whether behavior is welcome. And the Supreme Court also at that time, again, this is about 30 years ago, talked about a hostile environment, recognized that a hostile environment, an environment where sex harassment, where individuals are, their workplace is made intolerable because of sexually oriented behavior, that is also illegal. It's called hostile environment sexual harassment. Even if somebody doesn't ever touch anybody, but just by making comments or similar kinds of behavior. And there's been an evolution, and please forgive me if I bore you for a minute, but what the Supreme Court, what the courts also decided a few years during this period was, we're not going to look at behavior from the perspective of a reasonable person. So is this behavior unwelcome or harassing in the view of a reasonable person, or should it be considered the view of a reasonable woman? So saying that a woman might look at things differently than a man, and behavior that would not necessarily offend a man might be offensive to and even frightening to a woman. There have been courts that have, again, looked at this reasonable woman theory. And what also started to happen is that the court started to recognize that these cases could be brought by a whole class of women, not just one woman or two women, but you could have a class action that supports sex harassment. And one of the first claims like that was brought against Mitsubishi Motors, of course, a big Japanese automobile manufacturer. And at that time, which was 1998, Mitsubishi Motors entered into the largest settlement of any sex harassment, of any discrimination case at that time, which was $34 million. Which these days is peanuts. But back then, that was a huge settlement. What also happened around that time is that the Supreme Court held that if a manager engages in conduct that has a material impact on the employee, on a subordinate, engages in sexual harassment, then the employer is going to be strictly liable for that conduct, even if the employer didn't know about it. Even if the employer had no way of knowing that the manager was doing this, if a manager is harassing a subordinate and having a material impact on their, denying them perhaps a promotion or resulting in them leaving the company, the employer is going to be automatically responsible. It's part of the reason why we have all this training and all of these policies that we implement to let people know that the bank prohibits harassment, prohibits discrimination, and if you feel that you're a victim, you really must bring it forward. Tell your supervisor, tell a manager, tell human resources, so that we can address it and we can deal with the problem. So we've had, and then one more story in terms of a big case. In 2006, another Japanese automaker, Toyota, they had a CEO come over from Japan to work here as an expatriate, and his personal assistant sued after he was here less than a year for $190 million, claiming that he harassed her. And of course, he had to leave the company. The case was settled for a lot of money, and it was a huge embarrassment to the company. So these harassment cases have been around for a long time, and they have presented issues for employers and, of course, for employees, because not only is there liability, not only is this something, of course, that the bank wants to avoid, but it's not fair. Not only it's not fair to the employee, because the employee isn't able to contribute what they want to contribute. They're not able to do their job. It's also not fair to the employer, because the employer hires people because they want them to be able to succeed, they want them to be able to contribute, and when an employee can't contribute for reasons that have nothing to do with their job performance or legitimate business reasons, it's not fair for the employer either. So nobody likes this. It's always bad. I put on the board just a very brief kind of overview of sex harassment laws, and I but And, you know, in the U.S. we have quid pro quo, which is if somebody says, you know, you do this for me and maybe you can get a promotion. That's unlawful, of course. That's automatically, that's strictly unlawful, and that's called quid pro quo sex harassment. We already talked about hostile environment discrimination. Bullying, when somebody just treats somebody very badly, that's illegal in some countries. It's not technically illegal in the United States, in most states. I think California may have a statute that permits employees to bring a claim for bullying. But generally speaking, you can have a rotten supervisor who treats people terribly. That's not illegal, per se, but it's really a bad idea to have somebody like that, because what happens inevitably is, you know, I'm doing my job and my boss starts, abusing me, behaving and treating me unfairly. And the employee may say, I have never been treated this way before in my life. I don't know what's going on here. Why is this person treating me this way? And they go to see a lawyer and they say, well, aren't you the oldest person in the group? Didn't you just take a maternity leave? Aren't you a minority? And the person may say, you know what, that makes as good sense as any, and I'm going to bring a claim. So if somebody is abused, if somebody bullies somebody else, if you have a bad manager who treats people in that way, it results in lawsuits, in addition to being, again, unfair to the employee.
Phil,
yes, please.
On that point, I'd like to make a distinction between a bad manager and a tough manager. Because when we're dealing in cross-cultural issues, there are many different management styles. And so you need to be especially careful, because a manager can be tough but fair. A manager can be tough and have high standards and high expectations. So all of that has to be defined, both in terms of what is the expectations for the managers, as well as what is the expectations in terms of performance and metrics for the employees. In many situations I've seen, especially in cross-cultural companies, there is less of a focus on that. And so for the employee, they can be very confused and they can think that in the US, this manager is bullying me, versus the fact that they would just be a tough manager with high expectations. So both from the management perspective and the employee's perspective, it is the obligation of the employer to set those expectations and define the metrics.
I think that's a great point. And so what we try to do, you know, and I know Alan and his team try to do, is if there's a problem, if an employee isn't doing their job well, we try to make it clear to them why there's an issue, why there's a problem, what objective factors or subjective factors are they not meeting? You know, what are they doing wrong? Oh, and also, of course, getting a sense as to whether they're being treated fairly. Is the manager, you know, properly holding them to this standard? Is it their job, you know, were they hired with this expectation? Is it reasonable to impose these requirements on them? Is it business job related and so forth? But trying to, these metrics that Elaine refers to, you know, not only thinking about them, but making them clear, putting them in writing. And we've spoken about this, we've done other presentations here about documenting problems and the need to put things in writing and to be very clear with employees.
And also, especially in some Asian cultures, there's a preference to hire people that we know. Because if we hire someone we know, then we believe that they will be more loyal to us. And that they will, and so the manager sometimes believes that his colleagues need to be his good personal friends. I would argue that here in the US, that's probably not the case and not the way to be successful, because sometimes being too close personally, you can cross the line. And while I view all of the employees that I work with as people that I respect, that's very different than having them be my best friend. And I think we need to understand those differences, because there are differences in culture and it has implications for how we manage and how the employee views their relationship with the manager and with the firm.
Which is trying not to jump ahead of the topics, but I think just to echo where Aileen left off, when we get into HR arena, we talk about performance evaluation, setting goals at the beginning of the year, document and communicate with the employees, and at the end of the year, take those essence of goals that you set at the beginning, measure against the performance at the end of the year. Those are the most solid evidence to prove that you're not treating them differently, you're not paying any favoritism, you're based upon what you agree upon at the beginning of the year and measure it against at the end.
And I do just want to, again, Elaine raised an interesting point about being friends, and I think that it's another thing to that it's in, you know, a lot of law firms, okay, have been sued for, a lot of partners have been sued for harassment or discrimination and so forth. And a lot of managers and people like that, like partners, can forget that, you know, you work all day with somebody, you're on a case with somebody, you're working with an associate who may be 20 years younger than you are, or even 10 years younger, or 5 years, or however many years it is. And you forget that you can forget that you're at a different place than they are. You're a partner and they're an associate. You're a manager and you're a vice president or a senior vice president. They're an AVP or they're at a different level. And you know, it's easy to, particularly when we work so hard together, we work long hours together. I know how hard you folks work here at Bank of China. You're here late. And you're here by 9 o'clock, I know that also. And so we spend a lot of time with each other, and sometimes it's easy to forget those lines. And those forgetting that can cause problems. Let's just to move on very quickly, and I talk about small acts of disrespect, and that's obviously, you know, the need to treat people well. I had it here that there's this new law in New York that restricts salary history inquiries. So why did I add that? This is a new law that actually that says that it's no longer permitted when we hire somebody to ask them what kind of salary they're making, to ask them how much they make. You can't ask people what their salary is anymore. And why is that? The reason for this law is because there was a perception that when you asked that question, you ended up, and you might be able to pay somebody less money if they're a woman, because historically women have made less money than men. And so the new law is you can't ask. You value what that job is, you make an offer, they'll accept it or they won't, but you can't ask them what they're making. That's illegal because it might perpetuate sex discrimination. And so I think what's interesting about that is that there's a social, you know, there's a purpose behind that law, which may not be apparent. And Elaine, I think you had a comment on it also.
So it's not just understanding the law, it's what's the implications therefore for your HR policies, for your management policies, okay? So first of all, when you hire and recruit, you do, as Phil say, have to understand what is the value of that job in your local market, right? Beijing may say, this is the value that I place on an IT person in Beijing, and that job is the same as in the United States. But the market price for those jobs is very different. So having an understanding of the differences is critical. If you have a deep bench of talent in your IT department in Beijing, but you have one person or two people in the US, not only do you need to understand the local market comp, there is a premium for not having a deep bench. If you're looking for someone, and I use the IT example, that can operate in IT cross-border, speaks Mandarin and English, but needs to have an understanding of US equity trading systems, fixed systems, and can also be a commercial negotiator with these US vendors, that's a very different skill set than the same IT person in Beijing. So it's critical to connect the dots, to understand what that means. If HR is doing recruiting through the internet or through different kinds of search firms, they can't just deal with a Hong Kong office. They have to deal with people who understand the local markets, and they must speak with them directly. So what I find is that
in general, people take their home market as their basis of knowledge and reference. And that you cannot do in really a global firm located in global markets.
Well, and we're going to talk about expatriates and the challenges. And that's an interesting observation, and it carries over into other areas. So let's move on if we can, okay? So sex harassment, it's been around a long time, right? What's different now? And well, there he is. Harvey Weinstein, October of 2017, allegations of serial sexual harassment, allegations of rape, sexual assault. He exposed himself. More than 50 women claim that he forced himself on them, many actresses and so forth. He's kind of the brand name. He put a big face on this movement. What a face it is, you know? So he is kind of, I'd say, the brand, the picture for this. Let's not forget, you know, our great leader. I mean, some might say that, before he was elected, the tapes and so forth, was it Planet Hollywood, the tapes of his comments about, you know, what he said, that was it.
Access
Hollywood, I'm sorry. It's Planet Hollywood. That's a restaurant. I knew I was close. And others might say that the Me Too movement, in part, is a reaction to, you know, to that, to what we saw with his election. I think that some might say that this is kind of a reaction to this. We've seen many other people in politics, of course, who've fallen. This is Senator Franken and his, he used to be on Saturday Night Live. Probably very few of you remember that. He was then a very respected senator. He'd been a senator for many, many years, and he had to resign because of this picture of something that he did maybe 15 or 20 years ago when he was on tour, I think in Vietnam, on a USO tour. With another comedian who was asleep. And of course, Matt Lauer, just across town, just uptown, I guess, who was making only $25 million a year in that nice little job he had. And he was also forced to step down. Lewd remarks, and he exposed himself and so forth, and he's gone. He's gone, and there are many, many, many other examples, similar examples. So let's move for a moment to China. And I'm not gonna claim to be an expert in Chinese employment law or Chinese sex harassment law. Actually, there are other folks in the audience who may know more than I do. Chris Kwok is here. Chris is a good friend and was with the EEOC until recently, the federal agency that enforces those discrimination laws, and he's now a private mediator with JAMS, which is a big mediation firm. So women hold up half of the sky. That was Mao said that, didn't he, Chris? That was a thumbs up. I think that means yes. And what is interesting, I will tell you that I represent many companies from around the world, different countries. I'm privileged to work with a number of Chinese companies. Women, there are more women in management, in senior management positions in Chinese companies than I've seen in almost any other company, including American. I mean, I would say that there are many women in senior executive positions here, which is very impressive to me. And you contrast that with other countries, you don't have to look too far to see a very different treatment. On the other hand, and there are laws on the books that prohibit harassment and discrimination, but my understanding is that they're not terribly effective. That there have only been about, again, this is in China, there have only been 3 or 4 cases that have been successfully brought, 3 or 4 cases in China. The actual damages are usually just a few $100s. It's not worth it to people to come forward, accuse their employer of harassment and discrimination. It's just not worth it to them. And the law is imperfect, apparently. But there have been some other interesting things that have happened. Again, around the time of Harvey Weinstein, this made the news quite a bit. the China Daily, which I think is the maybe the government, one of the government newspapers, said that what happened with Harvey Weinstein could never happen in China because we understand we need to be protective of women and we need to behave appropriately toward women. And this resulted in a huge backlash on social media where people said, come on, take off your blinders. It happens here, it happens here, just like it happens everywhere else, like it happens in the United States. And very quick, well, I'll also say that this is still a huge story. This is today's New York Times. I don't know how many of you saw this, okay? This is the headline, wanted at Chinese startups. Attractive women, coders, people who work in these high-tech companies. And this is a picture from today's New York Times. This woman is employed to help the male coders relax, to make their job a little more pleasant. So she's giving this guy a massage, and the head of HR was quoted as saying that applicants for this job have to have these facial features, they speak in a gentle way, they have to have a contagious laugh, and they have to be taller than 5'2". I'm not sure why that is, but, and interestingly, when I was researching this presentation, I saw that in China still, and again, this is the case in many countries all over the world, there are many jobs that say men only should apply, we prefer men.
So when I was at Morgan Stanley and we were building up our business in Japan, the office was only men. And so when I went over there to speak with the managers to talk about diversity, they said to me, well, we could not hire women in our office in professional positions because Morgan Stanley would be seen as the whorehouse of Tokyo. And I said, well, we are going to hire women. And so we did, and we hired, our first hire was a very well-known she was the first Japanese Harvard MBA graduate who had gone on to Kiyomi Saito, who had gone on to a career in journalism. And we had her join the firm. And all of a sudden, over the number of years, it became much more acceptable, okay? And so the point is that you need to sometimes understand the market differences and how you're going to approach it, okay? Why is there the presumption that when we see senior Asian CEOs, that they are always in meetings with a group of younger people, mainly very good-looking younger women, that always travel with them? That creates a misimpression, but it also could create an opportunity for some of the issues we're talking about today. So, to me, that's very much part of some Asian country business cultures. So you need to be aware that things that, contrary to what the China Daily says, some of the things that are ingrained in everyday business and social culture can be completely misinterpreted when you deal on a cross-border basis.
Well, and interestingly, actually, if you read these articles that have appeared recently, Alibaba and some of the other leading high-tech firms in China, which they're not, Alibaba has also done this. They've stopped, I think, but a lot of these big Chinese firms were employing, you wouldn't believe some of the commercials that were, if you go to the New York Times, you'll find a video that was just in it yesterday, the day before, including TV commercials that were used to try to encourage men to apply for jobs there with pictures of, women who would be waiting for them at the company, but
great way to find wives. It's like,
well, I don't think it said it quite that way. It was a good way to find women. I don't know about wives. It didn't quite say it that way. But what's been happening now is people are saying to Alibaba and those kinds of companies, you need to be leaders. You need to think about this and try to help social change. And I think that may happen. I think that may happen. It may take time, but I think that may happen. So let's also just a little bit of recent history and to show you how things actually may be changing very quickly. In January, I don't know how many of you heard of this Lo Shishi. I'm sure I'm not pronouncing her name right, but she was a student who posted on Weibo this allegation that her supervisor harassed her. And within 2 weeks, it got so much publicity, her professor, this is a doctoral supervisor, she was in university, was fired. And in fact, his name is all over the internet, his picture is all over the internet. And on the same day, the China Ministry of Education announced these plans to prevent sexual harassment at universities and colleges. So very quickly, it appears, the Chinese government reacted to this and at least said that they're going to implement these changes.
And I think if I may, it's also add on to the cultural issue, because people just want to lose face. I guess the reputation risk value a lot more in cases like this. That's why the action was so wrong.
I think that's true. I think that, and again, that may be, the fact is that many people lost their jobs over the last 6 months. And there has been a feeling among some people that a lot of people maybe unfairly lost their jobs as a result of accusations like this in the wake of the Harvey Weinstein cases. But nevertheless, were there abuses? Are there abuses? Yes, absolutely. Should they be stopped? Yes. So I think we've already spoken about this, except I will tell you that in the last several months, I have seen many, many more and different kinds of sex harassment cases after these Harvey Weinstein claims. Cases where somebody says, 5 years ago, I saw somebody assault somebody. Somebody was mistreated years ago. And how to handle that? How does a company respond when they start getting complaints like this? Complaints about behavior that happens off premises. I've had a number of cases where people have been maybe at a reception or at a party being held by the client's a customer or a vendor, and the vendor complains about inappropriate behavior, or the client complains about people attending their own party and from other companies. I've also seen even claims brought by non-employees where people are just associated with an organization and maybe they're a volunteer member and there's a claim that there's some inappropriate behavior. My point is that this has elevated the issue to a tremendous degree over the last 6 months, and it's had a real effect in the U.S. I don't know if you want to comment on that.
Well, the other point I'd make here is, as opposed to China, anyone can bring a suit, right? Anyone can bring a lawsuit, anyone can bring a claim, okay? And so obviously, but the burden is on that individual. They bear the burden of proof. But their view is that they can hold the company hostage because it can create problems of morale within the company, and so they think that the company will settle with them. They really never want to go to court. They just want to get some money. So you need to understand those dynamics with respect to how companies also treat this and react to it. I've seen many companies where they think that, oh well, maybe we can move the person to another job, we can keep them quiet, we can keep them happy. In the end, because in the United States, the environment is so litigious, you have to understand, you have to create preventative environment so that you don't create more opportunities for these types of claims.
And which is what we have done. We have, what we've seen is that companies are doing more training, they're reaffirming their commitment to a harassment-free environment, and they are strongly enforcing when they investigate and legitimate claims of harassment and discrimination. And I think that's been what I've seen as the initial reaction of companies, is that they have used this opportunity really to reaffirm their commitment to fair employment practices.
And it's not just enough to put it in the policy and procedures. You do need to bring it alive. And as we know,
women also comprise the majority of HR professionals. And that is something where I think, especially in this area, you can have a very great impact. Now, when you're training your young people coming in, I mean, I always say to them, remember, your market is vertical, not horizontal.
Which means what?
Which means you're not going to sleep with your, you're not going to sleep with your client, your boss, or your customer. Okay? And I'm very direct. And coming from a woman to other young women or men, they feel a little uncomfortable. But I have that same speech with the managers. Okay? And they are very uncomfortable about that. And I know that. But you have to be very clear and very direct, because many of the young women, especially Asian women working in the United States where it could be their first job, they have no sense of what the expectations are or the boundaries.
So let's talk for a second about, if we could just talk about Chinese cultural issues. You worked in China, and I wonder if you want to just spend 2 minutes talking about, you know, the difference between, you know, I think in the US we do see many people bring these claims. In China, obviously, there's less opportunity to bring it because the law doesn't permit it. But is there a different culture too that would suggest that people wouldn't want to bring those kinds of claims?
Yeah, why don't you? So I'm only really focusing here, so I wasn't sure exactly.
You weren't focused across culture.
Yeah.
Okay, so in my experience, and looking at both the companies in China as in the United States, there tends to be in China much more of a top-down hierarchical management structure, a little bit more command and control, and you see that much more in the state-owned enterprises. In the private sector, smaller or emerging companies, you have the strong founder, a little bit the emperor, and all decisions are made by the chairman and they come down. Communication does not necessarily flow easily up. Everyone tends to operate in what's my area, what's my box, not necessarily across departments. Okay, so it's sometimes hard to infiltrate the culture. So if you think about that, and you think perhaps of more global companies and many in the United States, you'll find that management is much more dispersed. It's much flatter. Yes, there are senior levels, but everyone works much more collaboratively, hopefully. Okay. Huge implications in interviewing. When I work with my colleagues in Beijing, the managers want to hire people they know, people that are weaker than them, and people that they think that will be completely loyal to them personally, rather than to the institutional. Whereas I say, I always want to interview and hire someone stronger than me. I want people who want to have my job, because that will give me liquidity and other opportunities within the firm. Completely different perspective. But the fundamental difference I see between East and West is that in US business, I just meet you for the first time as a stranger, but I know the company you work with, I will implicitly trust you on a business level until you mess up with me. In China, I have to earn that trust and respect over a period of time. A complete difference in approach, okay? And if you understand that, you understand the difference in the problems that we have in business, cross-culturally, and you understand the differences in politics also. So that, to me, is fundamental, okay? The hierarchy and the interviewing. And because of the hierarchy, junior people don't always speak up. They're afraid to speak up. So not only about problems, but also about good ideas and fostering innovation, et cetera. And what are the subtle messages that we send? Many times people say, oh, we have an open culture, this, that, and the other, but they don't act that way, okay? So to me, this is gonna take a generation or more of re-educating managers across, you know, global managers, as well as developing the sales force. And on issues of client entertaining, you know, in the financial services business, that's a large part of it. Now, we're regulated, so you can only do certain types of entertaining, you can only spend so much money. That's very different in many other cultures, where
you're expected to do a lot of drinking, where you're expected to be out late or to go to different places. Now, a woman could view that as harassment, right? She doesn't want to have to be forced to go out with a group of men however many times a week and drink Mai Tai and do karaoke until 2 o'clock in the morning. You know, that's not part of the job description. So understanding these subtleties, I think, is critical as an HR manager.
Can we, we started a little late. I'm wondering if we can go just maybe 10 minutes after, till about 10 after, or because we're running, we're a little short of time. Is everybody okay if we go just a few minutes longer? Okay.
Yes.
So let's, Alan, I wonder if there's anything you want to add to this. You had mentioned the idea of horseplay and so forth, and maybe the challenges of expats who come to the U.S.
Right. I think it's the understanding of culture, and here, I guess the sensitivity to sexual harassment is probably coming from a different angle. I think the problem is not really entirely to the expatriate. I think also found it with local management as well. I think exactly what Elaine has said. A lot of times, people tend to hire a subject matter expert, a person who is good at what they're doing, rather than a manager. There's a lot more to it when you have to recruit somebody with a management skill set. And here, I've seen repeatedly people come in with a very strong skill set in performing their tasks, but not to manage people. So that lead to, when it comes to situation with complaints, with, you know, among others, sexual harassment complaint, hostile harassment complaint, all these actually lead to the act of not looking into it rather than just sitting on it and let it ride. Hopefully it goes away. And I think it never stopped that way, because we're dealing with, in our firm, a lot, you know, with strong cultural diversification. So people actually tend to speak up a lot more than just habitually, if it's just very small population or even within Chinese people. So yeah, things like that, I think we just have to take it a lot more proactive in addressing the issue promptly. I think among others that we already talked about, training the beginning, documentation, and when we have to get into an investigation, document is the most important part, which I think we repeatedly educate our experience in how to handle cases. It's all up to the time. HR will take the lead in addressing the issue and will assist them in writing it through the process.
Alan, is actually, you've made some other interesting observations, and that is, you know, Bank of China has grown tremendously, obviously, over the last, you know, decade, right? And the last several years, and it's gone from being a company that was principally, there were Chinese expats, and there were a lot of local people hired who had Chinese backgrounds. And now, as the bank has grown into this enormous building, of course, and has become much more of a force financially in the United States, and is certainly the biggest bank in the United Chinese bank in the U.S., you have much people from many a much broader, diverse, different places, different cultures, different experiences. People from like Morgan Stanley, people from J.P. Morgan, people from those kinds of institutions are now joining Bank of China. They may or may not have a Chinese background. More and more don't. And so I think that what's interesting is that, you know, you're not only facing you've got the expats coming in who may not understand that, there's a way of greeting men and women, actually, you know, that's different here than it might be in China. But we're also being challenged by the mix of cultures that's different than it was before. So this is also, I think, a challenge for many organizations.
And also, quite frankly, the role of HR and understanding of what the role of HR can be different in different countries and different in different industries and companies.
So why don't you talk about that for a second.
So for example, as all of you know, that the role of HR in China was historically one of control, and in really controlling the employee and owning its home, right? And controlling the mobility. So it was much more an administrative function and a control function, okay? The HR industry in China, I know, only has evolved in the last 20 years, because when CICC had its first director of HR in Beijing, he in fact formed the first informal association of HR directors, because all of the foreign firms really had foreigners in charge of HR in Beijing. So there really wasn't an industry or a profession of professional HR managers. So it's still a relatively young industry, okay? Now, in my industry, because yes, you have a lot of subject matter experts, but it's a critical, HR needs to be a critical business partner, and it needs to help develop managers, help to train and develop its employees. It needs to focus on the development of culture. It needs to understand the local market laws and how to operate. And on top of that, it has to be able to, quote, translate that between the US and China, okay? So we are a startup in terms of this development in the local market compared to Bank of China, especially in the HR front, okay? And so I say that because, A, there's a difference in terms of really development and expectations, but your HR function has to be a much broader function, okay? And I know that I deal with many of my Chinese business unit heads in China who view HR purely as HR administration, okay? And they say, well, we don't need a senior person in the US. We just need, you know, someone to do the paperwork. I said, no, not at all. So these are some of the challenges that you're gonna have also, and that sessions like this or talking with other companies in your industry that may not be Chinese, I think is critical to understand.
And I think those are great observations. And you know, I mean, for as long as I've been doing this, there's been the sense that HR needs to be more of a business partner. And I think that if for no other reason than the liabilities that face companies these days, the whistleblower liability, and also the importance of competing for the best people. You want to compete for the best people. To do that, you need to be a company that treats people fairly. You know, I was just reading on the way, on the way over here in the subway. Actually, I was reading about Volkswagen, which has been criticized. It's not really a human resources issue, but it was criticized as not moving forward appropriately after this whole scandal with their engines and so forth. And they've got a new CEO who said, we need to be, we are focused on compliance, you know, we are focused on doing the right thing. And it wasn't an HR message necessarily, but it is. It has to be a message that goes out not only to customers, because they're not gonna wanna buy your cars if they think that you're a terrible, you know, company that doesn't treat people well, but you want to be able to attract the best employees. And to do that, you need to show that you're committed to, you know, to compliance and to treating people fairly. And that's something I know that, again, that the bank works very hard to do.
I mean, and in the United States, litigation in HR is a cost of doing business. So think about it. Your colleagues at headquarters, do they understand that? Many of them are fearful of litigation. They're fearful of reputational risk, et cetera. And so what does that do? That lets the employees overseas know I can hold the firm hostage. All I have to do is threaten a lawsuit. Whereas if you talk to, you know, Goldman Sachs or Morgan Stanley, they know that this is a cost of doing business. It gets handled at the HR and business unit level, basically through good practices and procedures. The irony is that in the United States, it is one of the easiest countries in the world where you can hire and fire people, right? It's employment at will, and if you follow the practices in terms of performance and monitoring it and et cetera, you can very easily let someone go. There is not that understanding necessarily with my colleagues in Beijing. And so from that perspective, they somehow think that it's the most difficult because there are this potential for lawsuits. What I'm trying to say to you is this is just a cost of doing business and you never have to get there. But they need to understand that because otherwise it will make your job more difficult.
Well, the confusion of having an at-will employment policy versus firing someone that you have to look at the last line of defense, there's not a violation of any Title VII coverage. It is a fine line, but so long as we do it right, we document it right, then I think we will save a lot more money at the end of the day.
But again, it's about fairness as well, and it's about treating people fairly and sending that message very clearly, because...
And having the right managers, right? Because if you make the best salesperson or the best banker the head of the department, that doesn't mean that they are the best people manager.
So let's talk about the Me Too movement for just one more second, and whether anybody has the sense that that this will change. I think it's certainly changing things in the U.S. I think that it has nudged things a little further. Maybe the pendulum is swinging back a little bit after all the excitement, but I think that the sense that people need to be treated fairly and that women need to be given every opportunity is something that, you know, the message has been sent loud and clear. Chris, do you want to comment on China?
The EEOC, you know, the super agency in China, the Ministry of Human Resources and Social Security, would often visit us to see how we took in complaints, how we processed complaints, how we dealt with these issues. And what I understood that to be was that they were looking at their own institutions, because that institution was created only in 2008. So they're developing the processes and the ways to deal with these issues, because they know they're out there, they exist, they have a law. The way I see it is that, you know, to go back to your presentation, the 1964 Civil Rights Act had sex in it, right? But it wasn't enforced until 1980. So if you just stop for a moment to think about that, that's a good long 16 years before anything happened in America, because it took time to go from law to institution to process and litigation. So same thing in China, except on a massive scale and in front of everybody.
You know, we have one kind of wrap-up slide that that I think we'd like to turn to, and which is basically what should companies be doing? And I know Alan wants to, Alan and I and everyone here will talk to this slide, but I almost wonder whether, before we get there, you know, and this is what we do here, but are there other comments, are there other questions from the audience? Alan, let's jump into this then.
Sure.
What should companies be doing?
Well, I think you started off is the education process, like what we talked about, expatriate as well as local staff. That a lot of times when you see managers, they are the one actually running the shop. If they're not doing things right, that could cause a lot of consequences at the back end. So I would say start it off with manager, train them properly to be a real manager and know how to manage. And then for any new hires to come in, make sure we provide enough documentation and training to make sure that they understand what not to cross.
On that point, another issue that you need to think about is who's really managing, okay? If you have matrix management where you have local management and Beijing management, does your New York staff believe that because Beijing may set the comp, that that's the real manager? So therefore the local manager, they will view as perhaps weaker and they can take advantage of. So I think you need to understand those dynamics. If you have matrix management, then you have to make sure that your local managers have as much input into performance, evaluation, and pay as Beijing. Otherwise, everyone will think that Beijing is in charge.
And the good thing about us is that I think the bank should run a very fair platform that local employees will give the same equal opportunity to get promoted to senior level. And after the person was hired, I think the most important thing is to follow the track to measure against the performance, document it. Because so oftentimes they come in to complain about discrimination, they could pull anything that they want, but so long as there is a track record of treating everybody fairly and equally, and also when there is a complaint, make sure that you handle each and every investigation thoroughly. Make sure you investigate any and all that you believe has an understanding of the case. Document it, run it by honorable outside counsel, get a legal opinion, run it by executive management, and then you launch the action.
I think that if you look at these, at this list of best practices, I think that they're all found, and I know not everyone here is from Bank of China. We have a number of guests and visitors who've signed up, but I think it's true that we have strong policies. Policies have to have teeth. Okay, when somebody complains about something, there has to be follow up. The HR department has to be credible. It has to be trusted by management and given that kind of responsibility, in fact, to investigate problems and to make recommendations as to, you know, appropriate discipline and so forth. Training of managers. Managers need to know what to do. When somebody comes to a manager and says, you know, I think I'm being victimized by you or by some or my other manager, how does that manager respond? What should he or she do?
I would even say that managers need to be trained as to how to do effective performance evaluation.
Oh, absolutely.
When I look at the evaluations that are written by, I'll use in this case, you know, the U.S. managers versus the managers overseas, you know, they don't want to be necessarily accountable. They don't want to criticize. They don't want to make constructive criticisms of what their employees have to do. Why? That goes back to they may be closer with them. They may have hired them. There's an issue of personal loyalty, okay? So there's a big difference in terms of how people are evaluated and what you need to do to be able to meet the U.S. legal requirements. So training your managers how to do evaluations is critical, and making them accountable is critical. Many of them have said to me, oh, but I get paid to, you know, bring in revenues. I don't get paid to manage. That's a fault of the organization that they need to know that as a manager, you are evaluated on your retention, your development, your training of your own people.
And sometimes when I talk to our peers in HR space, it's oftentimes that we were told performance evaluation is a process. They could spend 5 minutes with someone, tell them they're great, and exit them. This is the entire time a person put in the entire year of contribution to their career and they expect to be communicated, to identify the strength, identify the areas of improvement, and have plans to nurture them going forward. That part is completely missing. And I think that's the job that I think we from Human Resources need to emphasize. And I think certainly I fully agree with what Elaine says. Training of conducting performance evaluation is winning happening.
I mean, I sat on a number of Chinese corporate boards, and I was shocked to see how they also use a numerical ranking system for performance evaluation. So how many of your companies do that? So if you've got 3,000 people in IT in China, and you've got 2 in the United States, how can you possibly rank? And of course, it will always go against your global operations, which tend to be smaller.
You mean they're ranked first, second, third, fourth?
Absolutely. Okay. And so how can you have these numerical ranking systems based on performance? So I just raise that because, you know, there are the unintended consequences of what may seem workable in one country is completely not workable and disenfranchises some of your global operations.
Well, there must be, Tiffany, you must have something you want to say. Tiffany's a good friend.
Oh, yes, and I, Alan,
and
had some exchanges before. Yes. You know, the Me Too movement highlights the sexual harassment issues that have been historic for a long time, but I think brings forward, you know, a lot of new questions. So, you know, you had mentioned that, you know, boss, subordinate and contractors are completely off the grid in terms of having sex, and that's a very good message. But if you are, if you have secretaries and you have employees that have access to your personal life outside of the workplace, and they know that you have a certain stereotype or preference, and I am a woman that is either a lesbian or married in a different age range or something different, and I am watching you do this, not necessarily sexual harassment, but sexual preference for certain women outside of the workplace, and I'm not getting promoted, but there's maybe another female colleague that is, that fits more into the stereotype. What kind of measures do we have to prevent that person from feeling uncomfortable or that there has been a gender stereotype in the workplace?
Well, that's a great question. I mean, I think there are so many permutations, and I'm not sure what the answer is to your question, but I will say that, you know, there are, these laws, of course, that prohibit discrimination and harassment don't only apply to the workplace, but they also apply if you're at an after work event, if you're at a company-sponsored event, these laws against discrimination and harassment may follow you there. So if somebody does something in another city when they may be working together, they could. So it's important to remember that we always, you know, we always represent our company when we go somewhere, when we're working on, you know, certainly when we're on business, and we always need to behave in a professional way that reflects that.
And you learn by situations and examples. So, you know, it was viewed as harassment to take a female salesperson with a client to a strip club, right? Well, it could also be viewed as harassment for a client to take one of your employees to a gay bar, okay? If one of your clients happens to be gay and tries to hit upon one of your employees, you would hope that your employee would come to talk to you about it and that you could work with them as to how to handle it. Because the firm has an obligation to speak with the senior client relationship, and the employee, you may want to move the employee to a different account, etc. But we have to speak openly about these things, okay? For years in the United States, sex was also a taboo subject. You know, the French were very wild when it came to sex. So talking about sex in the workplace was not something that was done even in 1978 when I joined Morgan Stanley, okay? So I've seen that evolution. And fortunately, you have to be the leaders in those discussions. And given one's cultural background, that's not necessarily something that was talked about in the workplace in China when I was working there, okay? So you need to be the pioneers in some of this.
I mean, I would also say, and maybe, and I think we're pretty much out of time, but I recently did a presentation with for the French American Chamber of Commerce, actually, and we have an office in Paris, and I remember I used to work at a French law firm about 15 years ago, believe it or not, and I recommended to our Paris office that we put in place a sex harassment policy in Paris. And they said, are you crazy? You know, we're not gonna be like you crazy Americans prohibiting harassment and just, you know, sex harassment. This is Paris, you know, everybody's very relaxed about that. And even the women, you know, thought it was crazy. Not so much anymore, you know, the really things have changed tremendously. And the Me Too movement has, I think, really open that up and made it much more obvious. So sometimes it takes time for things to change, but hopefully this is going to have a positive effect on women and companies as well.
The last point I would make is that there still is in the corporate world a reluctance to fire or to bring action against your biggest revenue producers. So if there is a great banker, a great salesperson, who happens to not be the role model for the culture, organizations have tended to look the other way. And I think what the Me Too movement is beginning to do, it's going to force corporations to really focus on the individual, not just their revenue production.
Alan, any last word?
No, I'm fine.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, everybody. Thank you so much for coming today. I really appreciate it.